Email is the beginning, it's the gateway. If you look at all the major breaches that have taken place for corporations over the last couple years, I mean, I would say 99.9%, and it's only because I can't think of any that didn't start with email, but there's probably one of them out there. Everyone you've read about in the news started with an employee getting an email, clicking a link, opening attachment, something like that. I mean, it's that prevalent. And so you figure if these major corporations who have more money than God can't stop this from happening to them, you know, just us folks at home, we're ripe for the picking. And that's what criminals have realized, is they can just go after you guys through email. It's been over a billion, that's billion with a B, email addresses have been stolen through breaches. And these are breaches, so you have an account on Yahoo, or you have an account on Amazon, or you have an account on God knows where. And those companies now have a breach. Well, part of that account that you have, you've given them your email address, which means your email address has now been compromised and is now owned by somebody else or held by somebody else, and God knows who they are. Well, once those compromises take place, those email lists are then sold over and over again and eventually end up somewhere on the dark web in big compiled lists that criminals can have access to use for all sorts of nefarious purposes. If you're ever wondering if your email has been part of a breach, now, this is by no means a guaranteed list, but there's a really, really good website. It's called Have I Been Pwned? It's haveibeenpwned.com. And the reason I like this website is you can go there and just type your email address in, all of those names. There's a whole slew more companies, These are all the ones that this particular group can tell you if you were part of those breaches. There's even more. So here I did test at gmail.com. Test at gmail.com is in everything. So I knew it would come back with breaches. And sure enough, it's listing a whole slew of sites where that test at gmail.com has been part of breaches. So, and then you can read about each company. It gives you all the details. So you can find out, has my email address been part of any of these major breaches? Now, again, this doesn't guarantee if it comes back that it's not part of any, that you're free and clear. But if it does come back as some of these things, at least you know, okay, it's probably about there a little bit. I should be a little bit more cautious about the emails that I get. If your email comes back as having been one of those ones that's been compromised, there's a few things that you should do. First of all, whatever company name it lists that it was part of, if you haven't changed your password at that organization, you should do that immediately. So for example, LinkedIn. If you have a LinkedIn account and it comes back and says, hey, your email is one of the ones that was part of that breach at LinkedIn. If you haven't changed your password there, you absolutely should change it now, because somebody has that database and there's a very good chance they've already been trying to go after that password. The other thing you can do is you can change your email. So depending on what type of an account you have set up, or if you have it through Gmail or whatever, you can always get a new email. I know it's a pain in the neck, so I'm not saying that that's a must, but it's an option that you have depending on how much you use that email and how easy it is to change it out. And the last thing that's probably the most important is make sure that whatever email or whatever password you used at the account or accounts that had the breach, that you're not using that same password anywhere else. And that's probably the biggest problem people run into, because people have this idea that they know they're supposed to use a password that's unique everywhere, but nobody ever does. People basically come up with a password, they finally figured out something that's got the upper and lowercase letters, a number in there, some sort of crazy character, and that is now their password, and they use it everywhere. Because trying to have a different password at 100 different websites becomes almost impossible, unless you're going to try to write them all down or use some sort of third-party product to store them all, and it just becomes a mess. As a hacker, as somebody that's broken into a lot of stuff, if you tell me that you have all of your passwords stored in one location, I'm in for that challenge. That to me sounds like a great day, because that just means that all I have to do is break one thing and I now have them all. And there's been apps that have been compromised. You can type in online, look on Google and read stories about that exact problem that's happened, where there's been breaches from companies using some of these third-party sites where they're storing all the passwords. So I'm not a giant fan. I'm not saying that they're all bad. I just don't like the idea of anybody else having storage of all of my accounts. That just seems like a bad idea, especially with all the breaches you're reading about every single day. It just seems I'd rather store those myself. So I'll give you my simple tip for passwords. Use it if you like. If you don't, I won't feel bad. But come up with one password that's like 6 characters long, and have that password be strong. So it has upper and lowercase letters in it, have some sort of a number in there, have some sort of a wacky character like an at symbol or an exclamation point or a dollar sign, something that makes it so it's unique. And these are your 6 characters, and you're going to remember these till the end of time. So you're going to lock that 6 characters into your head. Most passwords on most companies require it to be 8 characters or more. That's generally what they want. So what you do from that point on is any website you go to, use part of the domain name. So www.yahoo.com. So Yahoo's the domain name. Use part of the domain name in your password. So for example, if it's Yahoo, and you decide, okay, from here on out, I'm gonna use the first and the last letter of every domain name I go to. So Yahoo, the first letter would be a Y, the last letter would be the O, Yahoo, Y-A-H-O-O. So I'd use the Y and the O. So now my password is those six crazy characters that I've got locked into my head forever, and then a Y and an O. When I go to Google, my thing would be those six crazy characters and the G and the G-O-G-L-E and an E. Yeah, I'm sorry, brain fart. And so, but the point is, every website you go to, you'll know what your password is because all you have to remember is those first six characters and you look at the domain name. And so and it doesn't have to be that simple. It doesn't have to be that algorithm of the first and last character. Maybe it's the first two characters reversed or the last two characters. Anything you come up with, but whatever you come up with, that'll be your standardized thing. And then from then on, that's what you use on all the sites. So now every site you go to, you'll have an entirely unique password. It'll never be the same anywhere. And so you don't have to worry. But yet, everywhere you go, it's easy for you to remember because you just have to look at the domain name to know what the password is. People sometimes have their email through like Office 365 or Gmail or something like that. And what they're looking for is they're looking for some security assurance. They go, okay, well, because I'm using Microsoft Office 365 or because I'm using Gmail, I'm assuming that they're doing a certain level of security on their side to filter the mail coming in so that I don't have to worry quite as much. And that's what they claim they do. I mean, Office 365, you know, says, hey, we help secure stuff and we help try to filter things so we don't let a lot of that junk get to you that's dangerous or whatever. But you can't get this false sense of security and just assume that that's the case. And the example I show here was, this was a zero-day ransomware targeting the Office 365 users. And this was just in, like, it was recent. Did I have the date on this one? Yeah, June 28th. So just a couple months ago was this one where they were actually going after people on Office 365 and trying to get them to install this ransomware that could actually bypass the security that was supposed to be there from Office 365. So don't just assume because you're using a cloud-based mail solution that that makes you now safe. You've got to still use your own common sense and you've got to use your own, you know, kind of internal fear factor kind of thing going on, and don't just trust it because a third party says, oh, well, we looked at it and it's okay by us. It needs to still be okay by you. Once you're on one mailing list, if you start noticing you're starting to get emails from several different companies, you are now on multiple mailing lists. And what ends up happening is once you get on one or two, then it's kind of an exponential thing. Those two then add to two more, which add to two more, and pretty soon your email is on every list on the planet. I mean, it doesn't mean that you're now going to get hacked or that you've been hacked. It just means, you know, welcome to the club. And eventually, every email address gets sold. You're going to go to some company at some point in time, sign up for something, and that email address was there, and they'll say, oh, well, we don't sell your email address. But it doesn't always mean that they're going to keep it for themselves. You got to read the fine print, because a lot of times what they do is they say, but we do share it with our partners. And their partners then share it with everybody else.